Well, yes, what I'm going to present today is more how Bell Labs, Nokia and Nokia Bell Labs is involved inside this project in terms of ODTN jointly with Telefonica, and what are in fact from this project the point that we have learned, also the how we are progressing, and also the question we have in terms of contributing in the different phases of this project. But before to go into the details of how the steps we see, and also how the challenge that we may face during the next phases that Andreas spoke, and also Kartik has introduced in terms of TAPI, I would like just to make just come back from the present of yesterday, that saying that the network, especially the including the transport network and including the optical network, is in is transforming with a massive transformation, because in fact optics is entering inside the different segment of the network, reaching the edge, and this include many players that are in fact just a few examples listed here, with some communication service providers, some internet contents provider to name few, but also some carrier neutral providers that in fact also wants to provide connectivity to other users, enterprise that in fact are really in fact the customer of the network operators, and the data center service provider that in fact also required this level of control and understanding of what they are getting from their transport network. Optical networking is transforming and expanding everywhere with, I should say, some ongoing software transformation to control the transport network. We see that it starts, the current deployment starts with network management system, with element management system that are in fact specific to the network, the network element vendor, are specific to the vendor that I in fact deploy this network, and we are progressing towards what we say the on-demand provisioning, or at least some level of openness of the networking with SDN and SDN network control associated to the open line system controller that explained very well the interaction, explained very well the context before. And this also targeting with SDN this service connectivity provisioning automation. But this is just the first step going towards, I should say, application virtualization with service enablement, with performance monitoring, with fault management and troubleshooting. And the, I should say, the very long term is to target the orchestration with policy, with assurance, analytics, and control loops that are will be possible down to the optical network. What it requires for that, it requires automation and abstraction. And this is in fact to increase the optical network service enablement. For that, we have, I should say, different concepts for enabling that. It means that we go basically optical channel control as a service. We have defined this, we see these different, I should say, terminology that the transport API can provide, expose some different services in terms of topology, in terms of connectivity, After that, others such as OM, PAF computation, and so, in order to have this level of services, it is needed some level of virtualization, and for what? For what, in fact, is to enable these end-to-end services and this relationship, where in fact the optical network infrastructure will be sliced and will be exposed towards its customer to define what we call transport slices. And in fact, these transport slices are seen as provided to tenants, and these tenants partners are going to become virtual network providers of these services. And tenant partners are going to, in fact, sell and to provide access to their their service towards, tenant partner or end subscriber, and to provide, in fact, this end-to-end network slice to consumers. And in fact, the idea is to really provide optical channel as a service, in fact, and consumable as a cloud service can be today. It requires automated deployment. This is what the purpose of that, fulfillment of the service and assurance that we guarantee this service delivery. The point is, how can control platform support this transport network transformation? Alors, in fact, we are pushing, software-defined optical channel concept. But I'm not sure we see everything. But what we have today, from where we start. In fact, today, optical network is a fixed optical network configuration. It is set there. It's manual configuration. And whatever is the demand, whatever are the usage of this optical network, it never changes. This is basically the set and forget concept that we see today. Optical channel are guaranteed the setting with very large margin. We may lose or not. We are not optimizing, in fact, our network infrastructure. Deployment of service are in month, and this is usually locked to a single vendor optical systems. And we have also coming into the game the flexibility and the evolution of optical systems that provide more and more, flexibility, and there is no gain from that. And what we are seeing coming today is that we have this SDN control transport network, where SDN, in fact, the SDN controller is in fact continuously with a different approach that is more dynamic in the sense that we define a new configuration, we try it, and we implement it. And if it's not optimized, we continuously come back to the new one and adjust to a new configuration. This dynamicity is something already new that we are trying to do. This is also with the objective to set with just required performance. We do not have large margin waste of resource that is in fact implemented. And the faster delivery of optical channel application on demand, meaning that we do not establish an optical channel for just providing bandwidth, but according to the usage of the the user that it requires. And this is also targeting the multi-vendor optical systems. And associated to that, we have also the optical systems that are becoming more flexible, and also we need also to integrate inside the SDN control function. And this will also, again, in terms of spectrum, to allocate new resources, to allocate new services, and to enable network operators to have a better usage of their network infrastructure. And I'm coming back to where, from where network operators start, in fact. This is, the objective is trying to understand how they can open and unleash their transport network infrastructure. Today, we have vendor X that is usually working very closely with the network operator, providing its roadmap, providing its terminal device, its network management systems, and it's a very fixed way to define the services and to implement through this network management system or open line system controller that will become. And how we can evolve on that, how we can open this architecture. This is in fact what are the network operators are asking, because it's good to have a very nice dynamic solution, standard solution, but they start from here today. And this is basically the brownfield approach that Kartik introduced before. And here we have, in fact, the way to leverage what we have already. The operator will keep its network management system because it works, it's set and forget. It will keep its ROADM, its open line systems, and its terminal device, and with its proprietary interface. However, with the SDN controller, we see that we can, we have the opportunity to, through this standard APIs, to just implement a new interface or to new command interface above the network management system that can interface towards the SDN controller, seen as a network resource controller. And to extend on the softbound also some standard APIs based on NetConf or gRPC over with some data model, device data model, such as OpenConfig. And here we are starting to open our network infrastructure. Also, what is the good things of that is that we are seeing that the SDN controller can provide some northbound interface where we have well-defined what is resource, what is configuration and control of resource with the SDN controller, and what is service with this orchestrator. And also the beauty of TAPI, again, is that it will provide and will define what is the context for the resources and what are the context for the services or the user of these services. And this is, in fact, I should say, the first step we see. When, how it will happen, we are progressing with ODTN project to do that. However, this is just the first step of that. And we also do not consider what I just explained before, how we can virtualize, release the infrastructure, how we can use network control function apps with service and enablement, and so on. That's why we are, if we push the, the concept further of this software-defined network control resource, the idea is to maybe get a simple way to of the SDN controller to control directly the terminal device, but also the open line system device. And this is where we see this greenfield deployment, where the SDN controller, the network resource controller, is capable to control directly terminal device from different vendors, and with through a standard interface with netconfig, openconfig in the case of ODTN, and to report on the northbound interface the network service towards this orchestrator, keeping in mind that network operator will probably not get rid of this own way to operate the network. That's why it's a transitional phase where we see the network management system, for example, to have still some link with device deployed. But I should say it's in dotted line in the sense that everything is going, it tends to move toward this SDN controller as a resource. And we see also an important thing, if we want to target the policy to standardize the way to operate the network, or to at least to have this control loop, the importance of the intent monitoring framework, at least to have information that can be get from the terminal device and the ROADM in order to do what? To do some measurement on the health of the network equipment. And this can come towards, can be used by the service orchestrator to, in fact, understand what is used by his services. This basically is the evolution where we have, to come back to the first step, I should say for the brownfield deployment. And with our lab, we have developed with our Nokia equipment, I should say the first configuration and control of a pair of transponders through the Nokia devices with the integration inside the Telefonica lab that we completed this year in August. You can see the video explaining what has been effectively done during this phase. But just to summarize, we have a TAPI service request that in fact requests a DSR explained toward this Nordband interface, and ONOS translate this TAPI connectivity service request into netconf open config configuration for the transponder devices. The different scenario that have been implemented is basically the open config device setup and discovery, meaning how ONOS, how the equipment are registered to ONOS, and how ONOS in fact is able to invoke the service interface point of the transponder. The TAPI topology discovery, that is in fact can be reported to the customer application, and the TAPI connectivity service creation to between the client port and deletion, in fact to establish the logical channel between client port and line port between the pair of transponder. This has been done, validated. We have also over I should say auditing member that have done the same things. It has it is now progressing to the phase 1.5 where we still keep our pair of transponder there, and we are progressively integrating inside the ONOS the interface of the OLS controller and with the TAPI softbound interface. This is basically the response to the brownfield deployment that I just introduced before. We keep the TAPI service request on the Nordband interface with the new release version 2.1, and we keep also the translation of the connectivity service to the transponder with open config netconf and towards the OLS controller that we are currently working. There are many, questions related to that that I would like to maybe introduce at the end of the presentation. But what we want to say that the SDN controller just have the knowledge of the transponder and see the OLS domain or the domain specific controller as a black box and invoked its connectivity service, and may get also some topology information from the OLS controller. The question is today, and was I think very well illustrated in the Kartik presentation, is how the context between the ONOS controller and the OLS controller should be defined. Today, you do not establish on the way an optical channel between a line port of a pair of transponders like that. There are some computation that are in fact related to the different parameters of the optical channels, such as the power, the targeted power, the power range that in fact is possible between the source and the destination, and other parameters also that are specific to the open line system domains, such as the OSNR, such as the chromatic dispersion tolerance, such as the PMD tolerance and other attributes of the optical channel. How this can be effectively well computed, and who is going to take the responsibility between the OLS controller and the SDN controller to define this optical channel path is possible or not. Even if the OLS controller sees the OLS domain as a black box, there are still a way, some at one point, to have a complete knowledge from the transponder and through the different open line system knowledge of the optical channel parameters and constraints. And I am coming to the point of how we, in fact, take into account of the physical impairment constraints related to the open line system domains. And targeting to the, evolving towards, I should say, the next phase, the phase 2.0, where, the, in fact, the SDN controller has a full control of terminal device and the open line system, as a full topology can expose also its topology to a service orchestrator for different reasons. I should say that this is also the step that there are many questions that are still needs to be discussed and answered in the progress of the phase 2.0. That's why I don't know how much we will start really to consider this phase 2.0 with the greenfield, considering that this one has already many questions, open questions that we need to answer if we really want to have some things concretely done. I'm going to just open the debate here, especially starting with the phase 1.5, because I think we should, we may have on the coming weeks through our ODTN use case meeting, specifically, some question about how the ONOS controller and the OLS controller should in fact exchange information, and what will be the sequence of exchange of information in order to enable the OLS controller to say, yes, I have my optical channel, I have the T attributes, I can compute the physical, I can compute the path of my optical channel with some physical impairment constraints. This is maybe the point that we need to go on. And for after the phase 1.5, I have much more questions related to that. In fact, there are many points also that needs to be discussed. First, this is open. This is also an important thing that I forgot to mention. This is how the optical network topology is going to be represented inside ONOS. Today we have a network topology model, but there are many missing points that we should talk about. Certainly, if we continue on the open config model, there are extensions that will be required on these models. And also how we can enable from that optical device and link discovery and auto-discovery of the network topology to be stored inside ONOS controller. The optical channel abstraction in ONOS topology manager and how we can also define the different traffic engineering attributes and what are going to be added for the phase 1.5. There are some already initiatives. I heard some IETF work done on that, especially on the interface to routing system working group. It will require certainly TAPI 2.1 plus extension on that. And we may start with a few attributes such as the power and over. And also how we can define the optical channel feasibility and the computation. How are the physical impairment used and which physical simulation engine we heard about GNPY and so. And we have also much more questions to answer. That's why maybe the first 2.0 will arrive when, I don't know. And this basically concludes my talk. I don't know if I am on time. I just wanted to mention that these are interaction between with another project that we are doing with Orange under this project Sandate.